like to call this meeting to order, and I would like to invite Pastor Gary Word of the City View Community Church to this, the invitation, please.
Thank you. Would you just bow your heads with the Father, we're just so thankful. I am, Lord. And I want to enter your gates with thanksgiving. I thank you for people that choose to serve. Lord, I thank you for those that will stand in the gate of our city and make the decisions that are necessary. But what we're asking, Father, as always, is that your wisdom prevail. There's always a way that seems correct to us, Lord, but we know that that can lead to destruction. So we're seeking your way in everything that is said, that is done, that it be blessed by you. And Lord, we just give you all praise and all glory. In your son's name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the U.S. flags and the Texas flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag.
We need to hire a cat or something.
Is that a trigger?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. Item number one is consent agenda.
Move that we approve.
Second. Been moved second to approve the consent agenda. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Passes 6-0. Item number 6 on page 18 is consider an award of a bid for demolition of condemned structures.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, council members, on October the 6th, the council authorized advertising bids for demolishing 8 individual structures. You'll see the addresses of those structures on page 18. That bid was advertised on October the 11th and the 18th. We received 4 bids, which you have enumerated there on the commentary. And then if you look at the bid tabulation on page 19, you'll also find those. The low bid is PAT Incorporated at $29,960. This is a company that we've used on numerous occasions in the past. They have done us a good job. And given all that, we would recommend awarding the bid to PAT Incorporated in the amount of $29,960.
The one on Northwest Ninth Street, that's a wet demolition, or does it have asbestos or something?
No, that's a residential structure,
okay,
it's
just higher than the rest of it.
Yes, yeah, there's quite a bit to remove there.
Okay.
Yeah, so no, that's not a, all of these are residential demolitions, and just for the council's knowledge, if it's a 1-4 family residential unit, then asbestos is not an issue. You're not required to test for asbestos or remediate for asbestos. If it is a non-residential or multi-family unit, then you'd have to test for asbestos.
You know when they're going to start?
I would surmise, typically PAT starts within 30 to 45 days. So I think before the first of the year, they should have all this completed by the first of the year.
I just didn't know, like on the one at 2500 South Oak is one I've always watched, and I just didn't know.
Yeah, I see no reason why they shouldn't have it all wrapped up.
Yeah.
The only reason they wouldn't typically is if we get a lot of inclement weather and they can't get in with her heavy equipment without making a huge mess. That would typically be the only reason they wouldn't get it done in the next 30 to 60 days.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah. Are the bidders required to have their own workman's comp?
No, they're not. They're not required to have workman's comp.
Are they covered under the city then?
No, they're not. No.
They're not covered under anybody then?
Well, we don't require them to have workman's comp.
Look for minority ownership?
No, we have no policy. There's not any state or federal requirements for that, and the council has never adopted any policy as far as what they call historically underutilized businesses or hubs or minority-owned businesses. So we do not have any type of policy in that regard here at the city. Now, I will say that if we utilize federal funding, then those rules do come into play. I might also say that there's not any type of a Davis-Bacon requirement, which is a, you know, paying a minimum wage rate, and so none of that comes into play.
Anybody else? What's the pleasure of the council?
I move that we award bid for demolition of demolition structures to PAT Incorporated.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded to approve the award the bid. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? 6-0. Item number 7 on page 26 is consider a resolution authorizing the execution of an interlocal cooperation contract between the City of Mineral Wells and the Texas A&M Forest Service for procurement of engineering services.
Yes, Mr. Mayor and council members, this is one of the more unusual circumstances that I've dealt with in my time here in Mineral Wells. As you know, the Texas A&M Fire Service is working on constructing a permanent facility on the property that they're leasing at Lake Mineral Wells State Park. A number of months ago, an easement came before you that was dedicated from the federal government to allow for the extension of water and sewer lines to this particular site. Apparently the Forest Service was looking at this project, they contacted us and asked us if we might be able to provide the engineering services for the installation of the water and sewer facilities for them, with them reimbursing us for the cost of that. Never have been approached by any governmental agency to have that done before, and the explanation that I was given as to why they were asking us to do this on their behalf was that it would take them many, many months to get these services under contract. In fact, they said that they would, as we have indicated here in the commentary, that they would actually have to go back to the Texas A&M University Board of Regents to get the approval for a small contract such as we have in the packet here. My concern with this was that we would be basically in the middle between a provider and the ultimate client, and so I was somewhat reluctant to even entertain this, but we did begin to look at this. In consultation with the city attorney, we looked at ways that we could accommodate the Forest Service, help them get their project underway, make sure that the city was protected in any agreement that we might ultimately enter into. If you were to look on page 28, as you look at the contract that we have negotiated with the Texas A&M Forest Service, you'll see that there that the roles of each of the parties are very clearly defined. We wanted to make sure that was the case, and we wanted to make sure that the potential conflict with the city serving as the intermediary or the conduit between the engineer and the ultimate client, that we did not get embroiled in any issues between the two parties. With that in mind, we had them put into this agreement, if you look on page 30, item 8, Roman numeral 8, miscellaneous provisions, item G, work performance and product. Essentially, we told them that we wanted to have language in this contract where the city essentially had no responsibility for the work product of the engineer, that the Forest Service would look solely to the engineer for the performance of these engineering services. And if you look at the other protections we put in this agreement, and discussing this with the city attorney, we feel as though the city is adequately protected, even though this is kind of an odd arrangement, quite frankly. Our role basically will be entering into the contract with Stripper Rollins and Associates. We will then request the A&M Forest Service to give a notice to proceed, which we will then turn over to Stripper Rollins. and then all of the contact and communication will be between those two parties. When certain benchmarks are met as far as products being provided, then Schroeper Rollins will present an invoice to us, which we will send to Texas A&M, to the Forest Service. They will pay us, and then we will pay Schroeper Rollins. With respect to the money issue, if you will, we also, if you were to look on the following item, which is the engineering, the proposal for engineering services from Schroeper Rollins, if you were to look on page 58 of that agreement, or page 58 in your packet, if you look at the next to the last paragraph on page 58 of the proposal, we told Schroeper Rollins that the only way that we would accept this arrangement was that we would pay them only to the extent that we were paid by the Forest Service. So Schroeper Rollins understands that if we do not receive payment from the Texas Forest Service, then they do not receive payment either. So I think given the protections that we have placed in both the contract with the Forest Service and also with the proposal that Schroeper Rollins has agreed to, that the city has very limited, if any, exposure, either from the standpoint of disagreements among the parties and or any monetary exposure. Again, I've never really worked in an arrangement like this. This is certainly an accommodation to the Forest Service. I might add that they have been very helpful to us already, even though they don't have their permanent facility in place. Several months ago, they did quite a bit of work at Lake Mineral Wells State Park at the dam. TCEQ required the city to make a number of upgrades and repairs to the dam, and the Forest Service used their heavy equipment to do a lot of the earthwork and saved us quite a bit of money and time by doing that for us. So they have been very helpful to us already. This is a way to accommodate them. We don't believe that we're exposing the city to any liability, and this is again strictly an accommodation for them, but we feel like it's probably reasonable for us to do this. And we would present to you the resolution that you would find on page 27 that would authorize the execution of this contract with the Texas A&M Forest Service.
Any questions or comments? Go ahead, Wayne.
I was going to say it looks to me like we've got the bases well covered as far as liability in the city.
I think we researched it very well. And I will grant, yeah, the bases are covered. When the original contract came up in the consent agenda between the Army and the city and all that, I was not comfortable with the contract then. I'm not comfortable with the fact that A&M and Texas Forest Service, they knew that they would have these time issues. They knew they would have to go to the Board of Regents. They didn't have their ducks in a row when they came with this. And I do find it a little bit problematic. They knew their own procedure, and now they want to use us to circumvent their own policies. And yeah, it may cover us, but you remember the question I asked you, how much money is this going to cost the city? And you said none. But your time's involved in it now. Mr. Galt's time is involved in it. We'll have other people's time involved in it. That we will have money going out just on the basis of time that's being put in so that they can circumvent their own procedures that they knew would be in place, that they knew they'd have this time issue that they'd run up against. Well, and I do have a problem with that.
Yeah, well, I understand that. And I cannot offer you an explanation as to why they seem to have been caught up short on their timetable. That's not our problem. That's their issue. I did ask the question as to whether or not this was obviously acceptable under the rules. They said yes, they could do this. So number one, I don't think they are circumventing any of their rules, and we certainly don't want to be a party to them circumventing any state rules or their rules themselves. So apparently, based on their contracting parties that we've been dealing with, that this is an appropriate and accepted way that they can conduct their business. As far as their timing, I agree with you. I mean, why they didn't handle their affairs better is beyond me. What I would say is that there is a bit of a quid pro quo here, because Again, they have assisted us previously. They saved us probably several thousand dollars in equipment and man-hours. So this is an accommodation to them, there's no question of that. We don't have to do this. But I think, you know, this is an opportunity for us to, you know, continue with a positive relationship with particularly the local group. This is obviously coming out of Bryan College Station, and it's not really the problem, let's put it this way, if there's a problem, it really wasn't created by the local folks here. We certainly would like to maintain a good, positive relationship with them. So that's really, we're trying to do this as a good neighbor more than anything else, so.
Before the vote, I have nothing against the local Forest Service people. I do take issue that this is how College Station and Bryan want to do business with municipalities. So when I vote no, it's on the principle of poor administration and poor management.
Any other comments? Questions? What's the pleasure of the council?
Move to approve the resolution.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded to approve the resolution. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
Any abstention? Passes 5-1. Item number 8 on page 56 is consider resolution authorizing the execution of professional services agreement with Trickle Rollins and Associates for engineering services related to Texas A&M Forest Service facility.
Okay, well, to a great extent, we've discussed this particular proposal. What you'll find is that the total proposal amount is for $24,500, $17,000 being for the initial design surveying and preliminary design and preparation of final plans and specifications adequate for bidding purposes, and then $7,500 for construction staking and construction oversight. Again, Trickle Rollins understands and acknowledges the fact that they will be paid only to the degree that we will be paid by the Texas Forest Service, so the city is not incurring any financial liability entering into this agreement. So we would recommend the council approve the resolution you find on page 57, authorizing the mayor to execute this proposal.
Questions, comments?
Same objection previously noted, Mayor.
What's the pleasure of the council?
Move to approve the resolution.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded to approve the resolution. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
Any abstentions? Passes 6-5-1. Can't end. Item 9, page 61, to consider policy for budget allocations to nonprofit organizations.
Yes, Mr. Mayor and council members, previously the council had been approached by one of our local nonprofits about funding, and the council's response to that was that y'all wanted to establish some type of a process rather than just receiving requests, you know, at any time during the year, and put together more of a structured process on how to deal with such requests. What you'll find on page 62 is essentially a policy that we at the staff level have devised, and this is strictly served for y'all's consideration. You may agree with it, you may not, you may want to tweak some of it. This is just our recommendation is what we think would be a reasonable approach to this issue. If you were to look at the application process, essentially what we are suggesting is to have an application period that would essentially run during the months of January and February of any given year. In this particular case for next year, it would be January 4th through February 29th. We have a leap year next year, so that doesn't happen very often, as you know. What we would also recommend is after the application period is closed at the end of February, that the council, if you all see fit, would be to appoint a committee to receive this information. If the committee so chose, to have the organizations make presentations as to what they would use the money for. You can see here the kind of information that would be requested of them in a presentation. and then the committee report back to the city council with respect to their recommendations based upon the application submitted in the first part of June. The idea here would be that what we would like to do from the staff standpoint would be to have some direction from the city council on those organizations and the funding amounts prior to July 1st, because the city manager's budget is presented in the latter part of July, and as we saw during the last budget process, it's very difficult for us to make changes on the move given the time constraints that we are dealing with as of that time. So if at all possible, working under this kind of process, the council could give the staff direction and say, we would like to have, as far as the nonprofit fundings, these agencies included in the budget at these allocation amounts. And then we could put them in the budget. That would pretty much be an established direction as we get into the budget process. And certainly it could be changed at that point, but hopefully that would be something we wouldn't have to change. So you can see that that is essentially the process we're recommending. If you look on page 64, you'll see a proposed application form that specifies the type of information that we would be requesting from these agencies and organizations. It's fairly detailed, but not so exhaustive that it would prevent someone from wanting to engage in that process. And then we also have a post-funding report that we would are recommending that at the end of each fiscal year that these would be presented to us. Now, what I would say, and it's not really that clear in this process here, is that every funding agency going forward would be required to enter into a contract, and if they were approved, and the contract is going to specify such things as reporting requirements, the frequency. You know, it may be that quarterly is fine for most or all of these agencies. It may be some of these agencies you would like to get a monthly report from. So we will be entering into new contracts with all of these agencies, even though we have some that we have contracts that have been continuing contracts for many years. Essentially what we'll do as a part of this process for next year, starting next year, we would also look at rewriting all the contracts, make sure that everything was specified in the contracts that the contract that the council believes is appropriate. Councilman Wright asked me as we were discussing this earlier, what about the bounce program? What I would recommend where they are concerned, since there's already been some direction from the council that you would like to provide them some funding for this year. Now, this is not for this year. This is for the upcoming fiscal year. But what we could request, even from bounce, is for future years, if they believe that they would like to participate in a program here, to minimally fill out an application, give us the best information that they can at that time. And if the council wants to make a preliminary allocation, then they could do that for the subsequent year. But this is what we have prepared. As far as the staff's concerned, we wanted to get this to you by this time so y'all would have an opportunity to look at it, review it, not necessarily take any action on it tonight if you didn't want to, but if you do want to start with an application period in January, then this gives us a couple of months so that you can review this, consider it, and if you want to restructure whatever y'all want to do, certainly that's at your disposal to do that.
The organizations you're talking about basically right now, and I talked to Juanita about on page 22 of the current budget, is all those items there and what we're talking about? And then when we also discussed, there has not been anything in the past that we've offered money to anybody else. The bounce program's been the only one.
Yes, typically the only
this is everything right now that we
yeah, typically the only agencies that have been funded through the budget process. In fact, bounce is the only one I can recall that we have provided any funding out of unallocated reserve that was not included in the budget originally adopted.
That's so, the one past year, whatever.
Beg your pardon?
That's the only one that you can know of in the past.
That's the only one I can recall. I don't know if you can recall any, but my recollection is that's the only one. The only change that might have been with Paul Lawrence Dunbar, who we then reallocated Dunbar Neighborhood Council's allocation to them, but it didn't change the budgeted amount. This is the only one that we've come out of unallocated reserve in mid-year, if you will, that I have any recollection of.
And I guess the only other thing I wanted to comment on about it is that I like the proposal, but I don't like the committee part of it. I would like to see a called meeting when they do the presentation, not at a regular city council meeting, but at a called meeting. Is that what it's called? Call meeting or whatever the term is used, is that we would be the council members that wanted to be present for that meeting, where we would all be able to see the presentation and all be able to see it, instead of just relying on whatever size that committee would be. I'd rather be a part of it somehow, but I'd rather see the whole council be part of it when someone makes a presentation instead of just a committee. And it wouldn't be part of a regular council meeting. It'd be a called meeting. That's the only part I would like to see changed.
I guess what I would say to that, councilman, is that's fine and dandy if it's one presentation and we only get one request. What do you do if it's 20?
Then we have 20 presentations and we sit here and listen to all 20? That's our job.
No, that's the whole point of having committees and guidelines and protocols to determine these needs. That was part of this process, so we don't get bogged down and waste how many hours of our lives like you wasted during the budget process, lobbying for one group. That was why we asked for this, so this wouldn't get bogged down like that.
It wouldn't be bogged down, sir. It'd be a meeting away from the council meeting. That's only my recommendation. That's the only thing I wanted to see.
If I might add one other thing that's just not immediately obvious, what this would require is that beginning next year, if you were to adopt this plan, you know, our proposal essentially is that every year, every agency comes forward with an application and makes a presentation. So even though we have about a half a dozen groups that are currently being funded, if y'all were to approve this, then they would be notified that they would have to fill out an application, even if they've been funded, like Meals on Wheels, for example, has been funded for the last 20 years that I know of, maybe longer. But they would be required, as everyone else, every year to come in and then make a presentation, submit an application, and that they would basically have to vie for funding or essentially justify their funding every year, so no one is grandfathered in from one year to the next. So just to make that clear, that's a part of the way we view this process. So whether it's Meals on Wheels, not singling them out, or the senior center, they've been funded for multiple years, but every agency that is requesting funding in a subsequent fiscal year would be requested to fill out the application and make a presentation every year, so that there is literally competition, per se, for those dollars and justification each year.
Let me apologize, Councilman Wright, because that was unnecessarily hostile towards you, my previous statement.
No problem.
But, you know, I'm looking at the required attachments for the proposal. You know, part of the point of a committee would be to make sure that what they have in these required attachments. Do the articles of incorporation meet what they're supposed to? You know, their bylaws. Is there things in their bylaws that conflict with city issues, city policies? You know, who's on their board of directors, etc. I mean, there's any number of factors that you want to weed these things through in a committee before you ever let it come up here. Otherwise, you can have people that aren't genuinely qualified coming up making presentations, and then we're wasting time on people that didn't actually fill out the paperwork correctly. So, I understand you want to give everybody a voice, and I can respect you wanting to give everybody a voice.
Not that I'm wanting to give everybody, but they're going to get a voice that matters to the committee or the council. I just would like to see the presentation. What they all do. I'm not, you know.
We'll be able to go to the meeting and how it's worked in the past, but if
the point,
kind of like school board issues that come up, we could still go. They would just have to make it noted.
I asked
that we will be there.
I asked the city manager that same question, and I don't have a problem with that. And I, again, we get to the point where he said, again, it's a called meeting or whatever, even as a committee, is that correct?
Yeah, essentially what we would do, it's been our practice, is we have a committee of two or three, even with our boards and commissions committee, we'll post that.
And that's.
Just so, just to stay in good stead with the open meetings.
And that's the point I was making. There was a comment back to me saying, well, and I was concerned about the open meetings. You know, if we have a committee of, I would consider a committee of three, but if we have a committee of three and it's posted, then I can go to that meeting and listen to what's going on, so I can follow the presentation, hear what they're doing. I don't need to be an input into the committee, but I could be able to hear, and that's what I'm after. I'm just wanting to be able to participate by hearing what they're presenting, how they're going through it. Then when it does come to council, I have a better understanding what's going on. That's what I'm after. I mean, if we want to do the committee, that's fine. If I'm allowed to go to that committee meeting, is that correct?
You are. It would be a public meeting. It would be posted.
Right. And
you can appear just like anybody else can in any open meeting.
Okay. And that's all I'm saying. Just so I can see it. I mean, you know, I'd just like to hear what they're going to present.
Mr. Howerton, one of the issues or challenges that I have had and had during the budget process is, and I mean, this may be something that the committee would weed out, but, and I understand this was just to have something kind of prepared as a rough outline, but on page 65, the second page of the proposed application, and then also at the end of the year funding, on page one, on page 67, we've got supplies, personnel, monthly bills, etc. You know, my concern is, you know, I guess I don't want to see us funding someone's electric bill or gas bill that, you know, we're that major part of it. That's not why a nonprofit exists. You know, we're here for them to be able to do relief to specific parts of the community, not for them to sit in 76 degree temperatures in the winter and 68 in the summer. And so things like monthly bills and utilities or their personnel. Well, golly, it'd be nice to have Sally. You know, we can get $15,000 from the city this year. Let's hire Sally Jane, and everybody else will be able to, you know, take more vacation time. Those things concern me, that of the categories we have, most of those should be fixed costs that any business already has covered, that they shouldn't be coming to the city to expand their reach to do relief of actual needs in the community.
And I think these are just more, as it says here, as an example.
Right.
The paragraph preceding that, we want details of what you're going to do with the money. So this is really just kind of an explanatory, more so than directive, you know, telling them, here's what. So bottom line is, we just want to know specifically, and also in the contract that we will ultimately have with these groups, we can very clearly specify what they're allowed to spend the money for.
Right.
So. Yeah, this is basically just telling them, okay, tell us how you're going to spend the money. What are you going to use it for? Now, if they come in here and they say, well, we want to pay the gas bill, and if the committee and or the council as a whole says, well, that's not something we want to do, but if you're going to be buying food from the Tarrant Food Bank, well, that's permissible, then I think that's the point of contact where we tell them, you know, this is an acceptable expenditure, this is not. That's the way I would view that.
And I understand what you're saying, but you know and I know that, you know, if you put an example given, right, on how to fill out a form, what do people do? They duplicate that in how they write. And so, you know, I'm looking at this with the example, and I'm looking at people, some of whom this may be the first time they've ever filled out a form, and you know what they're going to do? They're going to go, well, we're going to use this much on supplies, we're going to use this much on personnel, we're going to use this much on bills. And they're going to give us an explanation based off of the example given, because they really don't have a clue what they're doing.
Well, what we could do is just eliminate that example and just put maybe above that detail on how the funds will be expended and amounts. And then they can just enumerate, bang, here's what we're going to do. If that's not acceptable, we can tell them what is. We can do that.
So after they do, after they fill this out, you'll write a contract? It won't be this particular contract?
No, this is the application. This is what they will turn in.
It's like if we wanted, like if I want a quarterly report of what they're doing, since we don't get it on certain other activities, if I wanted to ask the council to look at this quarterly, how they're spending their funds, what's going on, then we can look at it. That would be in the contract that you write with them.
Yeah, this is the application that'll go before the committee and or the council as whole. So y'all will look at it, and you can make whatever recommendations or changes, or say, we like this, but these changes need to be made. We can incorporate all of those into the program contract at the beginning of the fiscal year that they'll be operating.
Ideally, the committee would come to the council and say, we make this recommendation with these changes, and then the council decides that's good or changes it as they want.
Right. And then this can be the template that we can use to then work a contract. It clearly specifies whatever we're going to require of them. You know, the services they're going to be providing, where they're going to spend their money, so forth. The one thing I might add, and this is a word that's come up on a politically hot topic nationally recently, is that we all know that all money is fungible. So if we give somebody $5,000 and they're going to use it over here, that frees up money somewhere else. So I understand what you're saying, Councilman Reagan. Unfortunately, sometimes people just move money around because it's a fungible asset. But anyway, yes, we can make that change. That's no problem at all. We can do that.
Anything else?
And I might add, if you all have to decide tonight, we wanted to just get this in front of you, discuss it. If you're satisfied with it, great. If y'all want to contemplate further on it and make some potential changes, that's fine too.
Yes. On page one under eligibility, we have a little better definition of war equivalent.
Page 62.
For example, if you were a church, they're not specifically nonprofit. You could be a city, for example. We are in effect a nonprofit. We're actually a municipal corporation. So there are entities that operate as nonprofits, like say at the hospital, which I can't see them doing this. If they came to us and said, we'd like the city to provide us some funding for a specific outreach program, okay? They are, for all practical purposes, a nonprofit, but they are actually a special district that's created by the state of Texas. So there are potential participants. They're not necessarily, say, most people tend to think of a nonprofit as a 501c3.
So that would have to be determined on each application.
Yes.
Qualifier,
yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah, we're just asking you to tell us that you are a nonprofit or you have an equivalent status as a nonprofit.
Okay. The city council committee, is that necessarily made up of council persons, or are these folks that the council would appoint?
Well, that would be our suggestion, that they would be council members. Yes, appointed by the council or the mayor, either way.
Probably three of
them. Thank you.
Whoever wants to volunteer.
Would it be possible to appoint other than council members?
That's absolutely your discretion.
And would you, since we also had this discussion, would you explain why since they're a nonprofit, why they're not included in this, the Industrial Foundation?
Oh. We did not really view the Industrial Foundation as falling under this umbrella because basically they're an economic development corporation. They're a 501c6 nonprofit organization. But as we were looking at this, we were considering this as basically local entities, could be churches, could be the senior center, could be Meals on Wheels that are providing a social or community service. Industrial Foundation is involved in a very narrow service area, which is economic development, which we felt was separate and apart from what typically these other organizations do.
Right, and that's why I just wanted a better clarification. So
right.
If that ever came up, so why aren't you including them? So something like if the Boy Scouts wanted to come up here and say, you know, our organization needs to do this for the community, we like
yes.
it.
Yes.
Okay. And
yeah,
that's why I wanted clarification on the Mineral Wells Industrial Foundation, just so everybody knows. They're not really part of this.
That was not our intention.
Okay.
They will continue to be in the budget going forward.
Well,
under economic development.
Yeah, that would be our recommendation going forward, yes.
Yeah, they're just a regular budget item type thing. They weren't gonna,
right.
They wouldn't have to do a presentation type thing, which I agreed with what the city manager, Mr. Howard, just said.
Again, on page 62, the time frame for recommendations of the committee to the council.
Mm-hmm.
There's an example there saying to the council on June 6th, which I assume will be a council meeting date.
Yeah, June 7th
and
would be a council day, yes.
Decisions, notification, yet in June of 2016 in this case. That's a pretty short time frame to act on. That's one council meeting after we first see it.
Well, that's fine. If y'all would prefer to back that up, I think the real issue from our standpoint, well, as a matter of fact, if you look at this, we're giving the committee from March the 1st, based on this calendar here, until June the 7th. To make a recommendation to the council. I mean, I think we could probably back this up into the first part of May, because what we would do is we would take the applications at the end of February, and during the month of March, we would compile all of that, try to put some summary information together. We'd get that to the committee. That'd only take us a couple, 3 weeks probably to do that. We could have that information to the committee the first part of April without any trouble, you know. So we could back that up some. We were just trying to give the committee a pretty lengthy period of time to do their job if we went this committee route.
Okay, and on page 65, again, I'm also in agreement that those examples should not be
okay.
given.
Yeah, we already agreed to strike them.
I know
yeah.
that. I just wanted to reinforce it that there's such a thing as feeding too much information and then not getting information.
And the way I understand it, since it's a call meeting, they have the committee. If they're not comfortable doing whatever they're doing, they can have several different meetings and go through
sure.
this thing in all the times. So they would have plenty of time to come up with their best recommendation to the full council. And
sure.
then you guys would have plenty of time to do your budgeting process once we, if they approve four of them, and we should be able to attend the meetings anyway. We'd be able to be knowledgeable of what's happening. So I think the time frame is fine to me.
I expect it's not won't be unusual to ask them to go back and give us more information
right.
to the committee and come back at a later date.
Just real quick, I do want to say Mr. Howerton, Mr. Moran, and everybody else who worked on this, even though I did have an issue with the examples, first of all, thank you. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your work on it. I think for an initial go of trying to make the playing field more level to different agencies in the community, I think you put together a simple, straightforward, but very excellent package. I'll leave it at that unless the mayor wants to ask if we want to take action.
Well, do we want to take action with the changes recommended? So, striking those, that section?
We could
more time.
We could have this come up on numerous additional council meetings to fine tune it down to what everybody wants. And my feeling is that what we've laid out here tonight, that we have staff go ahead and finalize what we have here. And if we've got some things in there that don't work, there's always next year to refine.
Okay.
Sit down.
Is that a motion?
Yes.
A second. A motion and second to approve with the commission's recommended. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? It passes. Item number 10, page 69, is consider approval of pledge specifications and authorize advertisement and receipt of bid proposals for the repair and refurbishment of 5 damaged large storage tanks.
Thank you. Before I start, I want to apologize for my phone going off. It's new, and I thought I had it turned off, and it's not, so I apologize for that. Earlier this year, council approved us to move forward with soliciting bids on repairing the water tanks that were damaged in the May 2013 hailstorm. We have 5 water tanks that need to be repainted. It's Ram Tank, Welcome Mountain, Northeast 23rd Airport, and Fort Walters Tank. They were all hail damaged, and insurance is going to cover 100% of the repairs to the outside. We did come to council earlier this year. We had permission to go forward with the bidding process, but as it turned out, we were going into the summer. We had the severe drought that we're all aware of, and that created some concerns about having to drain the tanks at the time. Also, there was some concerns about the differential in temperature, that the water inside the tanks would be colder than the exterior, which caused condensation, which the paint wouldn't stick if it went to condensation. So at the time, we elected to postpone it until now, and there were a few other technical issues we needed to approach, which we did. Our architect's done a really good job in the project manual, gone through, lined everything out, and we are ready to go out for bid now. The actual schematics are back in this back table. The project manual is available if you'd like to take a look at it. We've gone through it. Everything looks as it is. Again, the architect's drafted it. City manager and myself have gone through it. Public Works director's gone through it. Mark Sparks, who's representing Public Works tonight, has taken a look at it. The only thing that we've added to this that we didn't have the last time you authorized us to go for bids is actual antenna array put on top of the airport water tower. That's something new because as we got into this, we found out also that we have 2 internet companies, wireless internet companies, on top of the tower. And when we got into it, we realized that we couldn't really paint it with their antennas up there. So that was actually a third reason that we needed to kind of take a step back. So during this process, they've agreed to pay for additions to the airport water tower by putting some additional scaffolding, that's the right term, but some additional metal works at the top of it, so we can mount more antennas up there. It's beneficial to them because they don't have to move to a different site. It's beneficial to us because we have the ability to put more antennas up there, so the police department, fire department, whomever needs something up there. We're gonna put a 20-foot diameter ring on the top, which gives us quite a bit of room for antennas. Also, we've had to go to FAA and FCC for clearances. That was another thing we didn't know about at the time that we've gotten straightened out. There's some paperwork that's got to be done to make them happy. But all that is in motion. We are ready to go out for bids, get them painted. And on Ram Tank, the Ram logo will be restored, and you will be able to see Rams because it's all faded away now, but that will all be restored, and it'll really be a Ram Tank now. So be happy to answer any questions. Mark Sparks is here. For those of you who don't know, I'm answer any technical questions you might have. I think we were in a good place to get this done.
What kind of damage was done?
There's a lot of hail damage. There's
not big dents.
No, yeah, actually, it's thick enough. It didn't, but I mean, it just blasted the paint off.
Oh, is that what it is?
And it kind of funny you mentioned that, because at the Fort Walters tank, you can see 22 bullet trails where people have been shooting at it. And, but they're going to go ahead and repaint it, take care of that. And we did have three, I can't remember if I mentioned, three that did have lead paint, Ram, Welcome, and Northeast 23rd. So they're going to have to remediate the lead as well. And so that's going to take a while to do. This whole project, in my estimation, is going to be $1 million, maybe plus, because that lead is really going to up the price. But our risk pool is going to take care of that. So, you know, we're going to not be responsible for dealing with that. So be all lead free on the outside and inside too, flat. And be happy to answer your questions.
How do you get an antenna? No, can I put a ham antenna? just kidding.
I know.
Just kidding.
We do lease that space out.
Yeah, that was for you.
Okay. It's a non-profit organization, so I'll get
it. We'll put a four lease sign up.
Okay.
If you can climb up there and put it up there.
Oh, okay. No problem.
Are the modifications that were in that ring up on that one tank, is it all included in the revenue and expense?
The internet company is going to pay for it 100%. They're going to pay for the survey that needs to be done. We've had to have some surveying done for the FAA and FCC. They're going to pay for that. They're going to pay for the actual engineering and the construction of it and moving all their stuff up there. So, won't cost us anything.
Free
is my favorite word.
I move that we approve plans and specification authorization to advertise, receive bid proposals for the repair and function of five damaged water storage tanks.
Second. Been moved. And second for approval plan specs for authorized advertisement. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Any abstentions? I might add, Mr. Mayor, council members, just
6-0.
So y'all will be aware that this is really the ideal time to do this. It may not seem like it is, but in this particular industry, the winter time is the best time to bid these types of projects, because what you find is that all of these tank companies, these companies that paint storage tanks such as this, can't work in the north during the winter time, and so they compete very heavily for business in the southern part of the country this time of the year. So this is really the optimum time to bid these kind of projects. Doesn't sound like it should be, but it really is.
Only thing I didn't hear, did you say how long it's going to take?
It depends on the lead abatement. Okay. That's going to be the most. And we're going to do them one at a time because we can't take more than one down at a time. So it's going to take a little while.
Okay.
Item number 11, page 71, is to consider appointments to the Industrial Development Corporation of Mineral West.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, council members, 1980, many years ago, the city established the Industrial Development Corporation of Mineral Wells. What this corporation does is that it serves as a conduit through which industries can issue tax-exempt bonds. We've had a number of industries here in the past that have done that. Weatherford Oil Tool, many years ago, issued some of these bonds. Also, Noma Cable Tech, which was the predecessor company for Southwire, issued industrial development bonds. And then Centron, when Centron was bought by a company called Ameron out of Los Angeles a number of years ago, that's what NOV is presently. They also utilize industrial development bonds. And these are bonds that are made available through the state of Texas through an allocation of what's called tax-exempt private activity bonds through the Treasury Department. So this is a very good means by which particularly manufacturing entities can access tax-exempt financing. There's a lot of rules involved with it, but if you can meet all the rules and requirements, it's quite good. At the present time, we're working with an industrial prospect that is looking at utilizing this as a financing vehicle for their project. We have not done one of these financings in quite a number of years. So the board that was appointed to this corporation, the board of directors, the appointments have become rather stale. So we need to make some appointments to fully recomprise the board. We need to make four appointments to the board. The board's probably going to meet next week, so this is something that, based on some timetables and deadlines for getting an application into the state, this is something of a fast track that we're on. We need to make four appointments to the board. We contacted four individuals, and I will say this, this board is a little bit different than a lot of our other citizen boards in that we need to have people on this board that have some kind of a finance background, understand what bond financing is, understand what debt financing and structuring is. So typically we try to make appointments to this board of individuals who have some type of background in this field. So a contact was made with four different individuals, Dacey Malone with Titan Bank, Don Crawford with Crawford, Carter, Thompson and Durbin, Keith Boyd with North Texas Pressure Vessels, Brad Wilkerson with Community National Bank, and each of them have agreed to serve. So we presented those names to our boards and commissions committee of Mayor Pro Tem Upham and Council Member Underwood, and they've discussed this and would have a recommendation for you.
Yes, we'd like to recommend the four names that were mentioned. That being Dacey Malone, Don Crawford, Keith Boyd, and Brad Wilkerson.
Do I have a motion? I move that we approve the recommendation for appointments to the Board of Directors of the Industrial Development Corporation Mineral Wells. Do I have a second?
Second.
It has been seconded to approve the appointments. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? It passes 6-0. Item number 12.
You did adjourn.
I didn't know.